Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. I begin in the name of Allah, the All-Beneficent, the All-Merciful. The great Muslim scientist, Imam Jaffer ibn Muhammad al-Sadiq, peace be upon him. Translated by Kokab Ali Mirza. And the Quran and Modern Science by Dr. Maurice Bucaille from French Academy of Medicine. For free copy of this book, write to World Islamic Network, 6769. Hazrat Abbas Alayhi Salam Street, Dongri, Mumbai 9. Website www.winislam.com. Introduction. This book is a revised version of Kokab Ali Mirza's translation of Maghze Mutafakkir Jahan Shia, the famous Persian book which has been published 4 times in Tehran, Iran. The Persian book is itself a translation from a French thesis published by the Research Committee of Strasbourg, France, about the contribution of Imam Jaffer Sadiq, peace be upon him, to science, philosophy, literature, etc. Members of the research committee have done a wonderful job and deserve thanks and gratitude from all those who love the Imam, peace be upon him. However, I cannot help commenting that when the learned scholars who are engaged in research failed to find worldly sources of Imam's knowledge, they indulged in wild speculations and guesswork and were even guilty of misrepresenting historical facts to prove that Imam Muhammad al-Baqir and Imam Ja'far al-Sadiq, peace be upon them both, had acquired their knowledge through the following sources. First, the Great Library of Alexandria. Second, the Coptic scholars of Egypt. Third, books of Greek philosophers. And fourth, Persian physicians. Library of Alexandria. The library, which was established by Ptolemy I, was burnt down 600 years before Muslims entered Egypt. There was no trace of scientific books of Coptic scholars in that country at the time of the Imam. Philip K. Hitti has described the burning of that library in the History of Arabs. Quote, "The story that by the order of the Caliph Amr for 6 months fed numerous bath furnaces of the city with volumes of Alexandrian library is one of those tales that makes good fiction but bad history. The great Ptolemaic library was burned as early as 48 BC by Julius Caesar. A later one referred to as the daughter library was destroyed about AD 389 as a result of an edict by Emperor Theodosius. At the time of the Arab conquest, therefore, no library of any importance existed in Alexandria." Unquote. Reference: History of the Arabs by Philip K. Hitti, 4th edition, Macmillan and Company Limited, London, page 166. Coptic scholars of Egypt. Macedonian general Ptolemy I had become pharaoh with a court that spoke Greek. He established a museum and a library in Alexandria. During the reign of the first two Ptolemies, the two institutions proved to be of great help in spreading knowledge. But even before they were burnt and destroyed by the Romans, they had ceased to serve any useful purpose. When the Arabs conquered Egypt, the country was under total darkness. There was no lamp and no light that could have illuminated the Muslim world. H. G. Wells had described the state of affairs in Alexandria after the first two Ptolemies in the following words. Quote, "For a generation or so during the reigns of Ptolemy I and Ptolemy II, there was such a blaze of knowledge and discovery at Alexandria as the world was not to see again until the 16th century AD, but it did not continue. The museum produced little good work after the first century of activity." Unquote. Reference: A Short History of the World by H. G. Wells, Watts and Company, London, England, page 97. So it was this blaze of intellectual enterprise never reached beyond a small circle of people in touch with the philosophers collected by the first two Ptolemies. It was the light in a dark lantern which is shut off from the world at large. Within, the blaze may be blindingly bright, but nevertheless it is unseen. Presently, a darkness of bigotry fell upon Alexandria. Thereafter, for 1,000 years of darkness, The seed that Aristotle had sown lay hidden, then it stirred and began to germinate. Reference: A Short History of the World by H.G. Wells, page 98. The name of the Christian, Jewish, Sabian, and Zoroastrian scholars who made contributions to the intellectual awakening and the progress of the Arabs after the conquest of Syria, Iran, and Iraq are recorded in history. Most of them had become converts to Islam. However, we do not find the name of a single Coptic scholar in the list of these luminaries. Learned members of the committee who researched the life of Imam Jaffer Sadiq, peace be upon him, did not and could not mention a single Coptic scholar who might have come to Medina to educate the Muslims. If there were any Coptic scholars in Egypt, they would have gone to Baghdad, which was nearer to Alexandria and was the seat of the government, where they could have gained favor of the caliph, won fame, and made a fortune. They would not have made a long and arduous trek to Medina to give lessons to the imams in astronomy, geography, physics, and chemistry, with no hope of recovering their expenses. Moreover, by doing so, they would have definitely incurred the wrath of the people in power who were hostile to the imams. There was also the language problem. It would have been very difficult for Coptic scholars to translate into Arabic what they had learned in Greek, when there were no equivalent scientific and technical terms in Arabic. Even up to the time of Ma'mun, who was giving gold equal to the weight of Greek books, which were translated into Arabic, there were few scholars in the Muslim world who could do the job, take that rich reward, earn fame, and get a lucrative post in the translation bureau of the caliph. Since there were no scholars who were proficient in Greek as well as in the Arabic languages, most of the Greek works were first translated into Syriac, an old language of Syria, by the scholars who knew Greek as well as Syriac. Then they translated from Syriac into Arabic by young Syriac-knowing scholars who had also studied Arabic. The difficult passages in the original were translated word for word. Where no Arabic equivalent was known, the Greek terms were simply transliterated with some adaptations. Books of Greek philosophers. Imam Jaffer Sadiq, peace be upon him, had attacked the theories of Ptolemy and Aristotle when he was a student in the academy of his father, Imam Muhammad al-Baqir, peace be upon him, who died in the year 114 after Hijrah, when the Umayyads were in power. No scientific, mathematical, or philosophical books were received or translated in that period. The work of collection and translation of the books began when Al-Mansur assumed the caliphate in 136th year after Hijrah. In the year 154th of the Hijrah, 6 years after the death of Imam Jaffer al-Sadiq, peace be upon him, an Indian traveller introduced a treatise on astronomy in Baghdad, which was translated into Arabic by Muhammad ibn Ibrahim on the order of Al-Mansur. The same traveller introduced another treatise on mathematics by means of which the numerals, which are called Arabic numerals, entered the Muslim world. It was the temptation of a handsome reward which had lured the people to bring books to Baghdad. Reference: History of the Arabs by Hitti, page 307. Al-Mansur dispatched emissaries as far as Constantinople to Emperor Leo in quest of Greek works and is reported to have received from the Byzantine emperor a number of books including Euclid. Reference: History of the Arabs by Hitti, page 310. Al-Hajjaj ibn Yusuf ibn Matar, from 169 to 216 after Hijrah, is credited with making the first translation of the Elements of Euclid and one of the first of Almagest of Ptolemy. But these translations had not been done properly and had to be revised or retranslated during the caliphates of Ar-Rashid and Al-Ma'mun. One of the pioneer Greek translators was Abu Yahya ibn al-Batriq, from 179 to 189 year after Hijrah. He is reported to have translated major works of Galen and Hippocrates for Al-Mansur. He is also said to have translated Ptolemy's Quadripartitum. Reference: History of the Arabs by Hitti, page 311. Translation work was done sporadically for Al-Mansur and Al-Rashid. In 213th year after Hijrah, Al-Ma'mun established his Bayt al-Hikmah, which was a combination of library, academy and translation bureau. He appointed Hunayn ibn Ishaq as the superintendent of Bayt al-Hikmah. As the chief translator of scientific works, he was assisted by his son Ishaq, his nephew Hubaysh ibn al-Hasan and many other students. Since most of the translators were Aramaic, that is Syriac speaking, many of the Greek works were first translated into Aramaic Syriac before their rendition into Arabic. In many cases, Hunayn did the initial translation from Greek into Syriac and his colleagues took the second step and translated from Syriac into Arabic. Aristotle's Hermeneutica, for instance, was first done from Greek into Syriac by the father and then from Syriac into Arabic by the son Ishaq, who had studied Arabic. He is credited with translating the works of Galen, Hippocrates and Discordius, as well as Plato's Republic, Aristotle's Categories, Physics and Magna Moralia. Reference: History of the Arabs by Hitti, page 312. Another famous group of translators was Thabit ibn Qurra from 219 to 284th year after Hijra, and his disciples were mostly Sabians from Harran. They were star worshippers and as such were interested in astronomy and mathematics. Most probably they studied those subjects from Imam Jaffer Sadiq, peace be upon him, or his students. Thabit and his disciples are credited with translating Greek mathematical and astronomical works, including those of Archimedes. He also received the previous translation of Euclid. Persian physicians. In those days, there were no colleges in many places like Jundi, Shahpur, where students could go and learn the science of medicine. If someone wanted to work as a physician, he had to serve for decades as an apprentice under an experienced physician. Medical knowledge could not be acquired simply by reading books since they were not available. Iran made little contribution to the world of science, medicine and philosophy. Only one book of astronomy is reported to have been translated from Pahlavi into Arabic in 198th year after Hijra by Al-Fadl ibn Naubakht, the chief librarian of Ar-Rashid. Ibn al-Muqaffa translated the famous book of fables Kalila and Dimna from Pahlavi into Arabic. Quote, except in the arts of belles letters, Persia did not have much that was original to contribute. The aesthetic temperament of Iranian population was a sorely needed element in the cultural life of Semitic Arabians. Next to the artistic, the literary, rather than scientific or philosophical, was the influence most clearly felt from Persia. Unquote. Reference: History of the Arabs by Hitti, page 308. Jundi Shahpur in Iran was noted for its Academy of Medicine, which was established by Anushirvan in 555 years of AD. According to some historians, the Greek system of medicine was being taught in that institute, but the language of instruction was Aramaic, that is Syriac. In AD 765, Caliph al-Mansur appointed Jurjis ibn Bakhtistu, the dean of the hospital, as his court physician. Abbasid caliphs who were patrons of the academy could not find a single book on philosophy, medicine or any scientific subject which was considered suitable for translation into Arabic. Imam Jaffer Sadiq, peace be upon him, did not serve as an apprentice under any Persian physician and he could not have obtained and studied the books on medicine written in Pahlavi script during the pre-Islamic period. It is, therefore, preposterous to presume that he had learned the science of medicine from the Iranians. The above facts conclusively prove the contention of the Shias that their imams had supernatural knowledge, that is ilm al-ladunni. Said Ali ibn Abi Talib, peace be upon him, you should know that knowledge which came from heaven for Adam and every kind of knowledge which adorned all the prophets of God, including Prophet Muhammad, may Allah bestow his blessings upon him and his progeny, is with his descendants. Reference: Tazdeer-e-Quran by Abul Hasan Ali Ibrahim-e-Qummi. Aristotle, the teacher of Alexander, was well known to the Arabs. They called him Muallim, that is the teacher. They must also have become familiar with the names of Ptolemy, Socrates, Plato and other philosophers of Greece and Alexandria, but they did not know what they had written and what they had said. Imam Muhammad al-Baqir and Imam Jaffer Sadiq, peace be upon them both, knew that the Muslim world would be flooded with books of the philosophers of Greece and Alexandria, and that the Muslims would blindly accept everything they had written as gospel truth. Thus, many of their false and fallacious theories would catch their imagination, corrupt their minds, and keep them under total darkness for centuries, which is actually what happened. For example, the theory of Ptolemy, that the earth is the center of the universe and the sun, the planets and the stars rotate around it, was generally accepted by the Muslims as correct. The two imams explained to their students who were to spread their teachings among the Muslims the theories of those philosophers, pointed out their mistakes and presented their own correct theories. Similarly, they taught them physics, chemistry, geography, etc. prior to the translation of these subjects from Indian, Greek and Persian into Arabic. Because they were the imams, that is, representatives of Allah on earth, they had the knowledge of the theories of Greek philosophers and others, there can be no other explanation. Intellectual awakening of the Muslims. The momentous intellectual awakening of Muslims witnessed in the second century of the Hijra was not due to Hellenic or other foreign influences, as some Western historians have recorded. It was the result of untiring and ceaseless efforts by the members of the Prophet's family, who worked hard under hostile conditions and made great sacrifices to bring about that golden age of knowledge. It is an irony of fate that bloodthirsty Bani Abbas, who were never interested in knowledge, took the credit for the intellectual awakening of Muslims. The standard of morality, knowledge and intelligence of As-Saffah and Al-Mansur and other members of that tribe can be judged by the heinous and horrid acts of savagery they had perpetrated. They murdered in cold blood thousands of innocent Muslims, men, women and children. They feasted merrily amid moaning and groaning of their guests, whom they had invited, and then cut into pieces. They exhumed the dead bodies of Umayyad caliphs from the graves, flogged them and burned them. Among all the Abbasid caliphs, only Al-Ma'mun was interested in knowledge. The rest of them were interested in accumulation of wealth, a luxurious life, worldly pleasures and satisfaction of their carnal desires. Historians and storytellers have placed a halo of glory and grandeur around the head of Harun. He was nothing but a tyrant and a despot. He slaughtered the whole tribe of Barmakids simply because his wazir Ja'far had children from his sister Abbasa. They were legally married by the caliph himself. His palace, with its annex for his harems, slave girls, eunuchs and functionaries, occupied one third of the city of Baghdad. He was more interested in frivolous pastimes, belly dancers and drinking wine than in science and literature. Quote, like a magnet, the princely munificence of Harun, the pure ideal of Islamic kingship and of his immediate successors, attracted to the capital poets, wits, musicians, singers, dancers, trainers of fighting dogs and cocks, and others who could amuse, interest and entertain. Unquote. Reference, History of the Arabs by Hitti, page 303. The Bay'at, that is, oath of allegiance to As-Saffah, the first Abbasid caliph, was taken in the year 132 after Hijra. He spent most of his time killing people and consolidating his position. He died in 136th year after Hijra and was succeeded by his brother Al-Mansur. When things settled down, Al-Mansur found, to his great consternation, that if Bani Abbas had built an empire on the dead bodies of the Muslim, Imam Ja'far al-Sadiq, peace be upon him, had built a greater and more lasting empire in the hearts and minds of the Muslims. If the name of Al-Mansur was recited from every pulpit in Friday sermons, the name of the Imam was also mentioned everywhere in the Muslim world. The teachers and preachers of every sect of Islam used to say, Qal al-Alim, meaning, the knowledgeable Imam said, to prove the authenticity of the traditions they quoted. Muslims had great love and respect for the Imam because he descended from their Prophet and because he was the most pious and learned man in the Muslim world. This made Al-Mansur jealous. He was also suspicious of the sincere efforts of the Imam to spread knowledge amongst Muslims. Al Mansur closes Medina Academy. It is reported on the authority of Mufaddal ibn Umar that Al Mansur wanted to kill Imam Jaffer Sadiq, peace be upon him. He called him many times with this intent, but when he saw him, he was filled with fear and could not carry out his vicious plan. Instead, he placed the Imam under house arrest. For a long time, the followers of the Imam were not allowed to see him and he was not permitted to see them. This put the Shias under great hardship. They could not consult their Imam even on such matters as marriage, divorce, etc. Reference, Manaqib-e-Shahr-e-Ashub, Volume 6, page 238. After the death of Imam Jaffar Sadiq, peace be upon him, no Imam was allowed to live permanently in Medina and spread knowledge amongst Muslims. They were exiled to Basra, Baghdad, Samarra, or Marv, where they were either held in prison or placed under house arrest. It was easy for Al-Mansur to close the academy of Imam Jaffar Sadiq, peace be upon him, by putting him under house arrest or by killing him, but it was very difficult to eradicate his influence from among the Muslims. They loved him for his ancestry, his piety, and his knowledge. Moreover, he had taught and trained 4,000 to 12,000 students who were spreading knowledge among the masses. Some of them were great scholars of Quran, Tafsir, Islamic jurisprudence, history and literature, and some were great physicists, chemists, astronomers, and mathematicians. Since Al-Mansur could not find in the Muslim world anyone who could rival the Imam in physics, chemistry, astronomy, mathematics, and other sciences, he spent large sums of money and imported books from different countries on scientific subjects. They were translated into Arabic and taught in schools and colleges. Gradually, the name of Socrates, Plato, Aristotle, and Ptolemy became household words, and their scientific and philosophical theories captured the imagination and dominated the thoughts of Muslims for centuries. The scheme proved so successful that in the course of time, Muslims totally forgot about the scientific achievements of the Imam and the important discoveries made by him. Kaukab Ali Mirza. Preface. Learned scholars from Europe have been studying Islamic literature from the beginning of the 17th century. It was only after the expansion of their universities that American scholars started doing research on Islamic subjects. American and European scholars have written many books after years of research on Islam and great Muslim scholars. A number of them have been translated into Persian. I have translated some of them myself, which have been published in Iran. Up to the Second World War, American and European scholars were not interested in studying the literature of Twelver Shias. It was only after World War II that they showed some interest in the Shia faith and its heroes. The research committee at Strasbourg, which studied the life of Imam Jaffer Sadiq, peace be upon him, and published this thesis, is engaged in the study and investigation of all religions of the world, including Islam. Members of the research committee, except the lecturers at the University of Strasbourg, are not permanent residents of that city. Most of them live in other countries and send their research papers to the office of the committee periodically. As reported by one of the professors who teaches Persian language in that university, the members meet every 2 years to exchange views. Names of some prominent scholars who are members of the Research Committee of Strasbourg, France, are as follows. Most of them are professors and lecturers of different universities in Europe and the United States. First, Mr. Armand Bull from University of Brussels. Second, Mr. John Oben from University of Brussels. Third, Mr. Robert Brunswick from University of Paris. Fourth, Mr. Claude Cohen from University of Paris. Fifth, Mr. Henry Corbon from University of Strasbourg. Sixth, Mr. Tawfiq Fahal from University of Strasbourg. Seventh, Mr. Francisco Gabrielli from University of Rome. Eighth, Mr. Richard Graham Lynch from University of Germany. Ninth, Ms. Anne Lipton from University of London. Tenth, Mr. Ivan Lennon from University of Chicago. 11th, Mr. Henry Matisse from University of Paris. 12th, Mr. Hussein Nasr from University of Tehran. 13th, Mr. Charles Pilla from University of Paris. 14th, Mr. Musa Sadr, great scholar of Sur, Lebanon. 15th, Mr. George Wazda from University of Lyons, France. 16th, Mr. Arna Lutz from University of Lyons, France. 17th, Mr. Elias from University of Los Angeles. 18th, Mrs. Durin Hinchcliffe from University of London. 19th, Mr. Joseph Manners from University of Freiburg, Germany. 20th, Mr. Hans Müller from University of Freiburg, Germany. 21st, Mr. Hans Romer from University of Germany. And 22nd, Zabiullah Mansouri from Tehran, Iran.